Imagine a world with buildings that can ride out earthquakes, bacteria that make gasoline, tiny devices that repair individual cells, even DNA, gossamer threads strong enough to hold up a bridge or an elevator to the stars. These visions of the future are based in the discoveries of today as a new science of materials emerges from the elemental building blocks of the universe, promising a future in which we can create virtually anything we want, atom by atom.
Can I have some rock music, please?
I'm David Pogue, and I'm on a quest to find the world's most advanced material, a narrow wire that can bring a fighter jet to a dead stop in less than 3 seconds.
Welcome to Navy Airlines.
Super strong, but not unbreakable. What new material might replace it? A man-made fiber that can stop a bullet?
Whoa!
Nature is our guide in this quest.
These are your lab assistants?
Inspired by the beak of a tropical bird.
Arrgh, they were all out of parrots.
Or a lightweight thread spun by spiders, now made from goat's milk.
So this one's skim and this is 2%?
It's stronger than steel. We're learning how to make stuff stronger than ever, and it's going to change the world.
You should try to.
Right now.
It would snap if I had upper body strength.
On Nova.
Major funding for Nova is provided by the following. David H. Koch. And
HHMI. Howard Hughes Medical Institute.
And the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and viewers like you. Thank you. Major funding for Making Stuff is provided by the National Science Foundation, where discoveries begin. Additional funding is provided by the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Science and by American Elements, the world's manufacturer of engineered and advanced materials. American Elements. Now, invent.
Here I am, inside a Navy plane. I'm on a quest to find the strongest stuff in the world. We're headed for that, the USS John C. Stennis. I can't believe it's possible to land on that thing. But down on that tiny deck, there's a life-saving piece of equipment that's supposed to be strong enough to bring our plane to a dead stop. Man, I hope that thing holds.
Going down.
Whoa.
I really felt that. Now I want to see how it works.
Welcome to Navy Airlines.
Luckily, I've arrived at the perfect time, because a dozen new pilots are practicing their landings. That means lots of attempts to catch that wire.
There are actually 4 cables across the deck. They're working on number 3 right now, so this guy's gonna try to catch number 4. That's the ideal one. Let's see if he does it.
The jets land under full power, briefly exerting hundreds of thousands of pounds of force on a cable that's only 1.5 inches thick. How is it possible that such a thin wire can have so much strength? I head below deck to get a closer look.
So I think I understand how these planes land, because I came in on one of these planes. The plane has a hook underneath, and then there's this big steel rubber band on the deck that stretches a little bit and then unstretches. Am I right?
No, sir. It looks like that. Yes, it does. But that actual rubber band that you're talking about, the actual wire, comes down here and actually leaves from here. This is actually the cable that you're going to see going across that flight deck.
Every time a plane hits the cable, this powerful hydraulic piston goes into action. By spooling out wire at just the right speed, it counteracts the momentum to slow the aircraft. The bigger the plane, the harder it pulls. It's designed to withstand a truly massive load.
The braking strength of the cable is 215,000 pounds.
That's enough strength to stop four F-18s at once. And it's all thanks to a strong material that the Navy trusts above all others.
The entire ship is made of steel.
Don't believe me? Tell it to the magnet.
Steel.
Steel provides the structural strength of the bulkheads and the decks.
Steel.
And of course, the all-important arresting cable. In the quest to find strong materials, steel is a great place to start. Our modern civilization is built on the stuff. But where does it come from? Thousands of years ago, ancient people used tools made of stone. That's why it's called the Stone Age. But eventually, they discovered how to extract metals, like copper, tin, and iron, from rocks. Iron is the main ingredient in steel, but steel is stronger than iron because it also contains carbon.
All these materials fill the periodic table of the elements, a master chart that lists the basic building blocks of every material in the world, from the lightest to the heaviest, from the weakest to the strongest.
The ability to withstand pulling forces is called tensile strength. And steel has it in abundance. But it's not unbreakable. Each time a plane hits the wire, the impact takes a toll, with potentially disastrous results. In 1993, this fighter had nearly come to a complete stop when the cable suddenly snapped. The plane was lost, but the pilot ejected to safety. Sudden failures like these are rare because the crew doesn't wait for the cables to wear out.
So the doubled up cable down here on the pulleys, you replace that how often?
Every 2,000 arrestments.
And they're connected to one across the deck up there that has to be replaced every
125.
How come so much more often?
Well, the one on the deck, we call it the cross-deck pennant, or CDP. The CDP takes the blunt force of the tailhook, metal-to-metal contact, at 130 to 140 miles per hour, 125 times.
It's amazing that they haven't found some material in the whole world that would last more than 125 landings.
I don't know of any metal that can do that yet.
Steel has incredible tensile strength. But can it be improved? Can we make this stuff even stronger? That's what Elwood Steel has tried to do for the last century. They've developed and produced high-strength steel for everything from aircraft crankshafts in World War II to high-performance windmill generator shafts and other steel components. It's all based on the same basic materials first combined thousands of years ago.
The end product steel is a mostly iron, 99% or so iron with a little bit of carbon. First we melt it, and then we refine it. We remove all the impurities we can to get the properties that we need from the steel.
At this plant, the raw material is scrap steel to be recycled. First, it's loaded into an electric furnace for melting. When the mix reaches 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, the liquid metal pours out of the bottom of the furnace into a ladle. Today, they're making steel for jumbo jet landing gear, extremely strong and stiff. Besides iron and carbon, the recipe calls for several additional elements added in precise quantities. After cooling, a simple test reveals whether the steel has the right amount of tensile strength.
When we pull a piece of steel, we measure how much it stresses, and we keep increasing the load and watch it stretch until it eventually breaks.
The more force it can withstand, the greater the tensile strength.
where does steel's remarkable strength come from? In metals like iron, the atoms are packed together like sheets of marbles. But when pushed or pulled, they can slip and slide past each other. But steel also contains carbon. The carbon atoms fit in between the iron atoms, limiting their freedom of movement and making it harder to pull them apart. Steelmakers long ago learned that by adding more carbon, you can increase the steel's tensile strength, but you give up flexibility, which is something that the arresting cable needs to wind and unwind. The trick is to find just the right balance.
Including steel, there's always been a trade-off between very high hardness, high strength, and flexibility. Steel has provided a very good combination of high strength and good flexibility for many applications. That's why it's so widely used.
Without steel's tensile strength to resist fracture, elevator cables would snap, and bridges would crack in two. That alone makes it an incredibly valuable strong material. But steel protects us in other ways too. Car makers depend on a different kind of strength in steel, which is on display at the Outlaw Motor Speedway in Muskogee, Oklahoma. Materials scientist Mark Eberhardt is here to help me understand what makes car bodies strong. And to do that, we first have to watch them break.
Mark, you're a prominent scientist, author, teacher. Why are we at a dirt track in Oklahoma?
I've been fascinated with understanding why things break since I was about 6 years old. You can go into a lab and you can do real detailed experiments. They don't capture the full beauty of why things break. This is the place to come to really understand what a person means when they say strength.
We're the Starsky and Hutch of science nerds. Can I have some rock music, please?
Frankly, I wouldn't mind watching from the stands. But Mark insists that only by becoming crash test dummies ourselves can we understand how steel makes car bodies strong.
Most people don't think of strength as kind of a monolithic thing, but it really is a combination.
Hey, what's your hurry, Pat?
Sorry about that. It's really a combination of properties. It's not just one property, the way most people use the word.
So really, when we say strong as steel, it's a little more complicated than that.
Oh, absolutely.
Besides tensile strength, resistance to pulling, there's also toughness. It's a measure of how much energy a material can absorb without breaking. When a car crashes and the body dents, the steel is absorbing the energy of the crash. That's toughness. During our 100 laps, the car took some serious hits. Did the steel demonstrate toughness?
You know, it's not all that much different from Manhattan at rush hour. Let's check this puppy out.
There's some damage over here.
The body got creamed, but the steel didn't break. It's dented, yet still intact. Our driver, Danny, suggests an even more extreme test of steel's life-saving toughness.
What do you got set up for us here?
We're gonna take this car, we're gonna send it into the wall and see what we can tear up.
Danny locks the steering wheel in place and opens the throttle. Now, it's up to me to do the honors.
In the name of science!
We installed a small camera where the driver would normally be. Impact was far more intense than anything we experienced during the race.
Mark, talk us through what's going on here.
What we can see here is that we've exhausted a lot of the energy in just crumpling this thing up. I think we knocked the axle all the way back. Tell me, is that the case, Danny?
It looks like it.
Knocked it all the way back into the firewall.
That deal will buff right out.
Would you have lived, Danny?
I would have had a heart attack somewhere between there and here. I don't know.
Amazingly, the car took everything we threw at it. If the material hadn't been tough, if it had been too brittle, the damage would have been lethal. But in this case, people would have survived because the steel absorbed the energy of the collision. The amount of carbon in the steel is low enough to let the atoms move just a bit, allowing the steel to bend but remain intact. That's toughness.
Who says science can't be fun? That was pretty cool. Steel makes the biggest structures on Earth possible. And in the future, when buildings reach a mile or more into the sky and bridges stretch across the sea, steel will be there to support humanity's dreams, because we haven't even come close to exhausting the potential of this most precious metal. But no material is perfect. Even metals have their weaknesses. Consider the suit of armor.
Warriors once wore bronze, iron, and steel onto the battlefield. Sure, it was heavy, but it provided good protection. Until around the 15th century, when the gun appeared. Heavy armor became a liability. So for hundreds of years, infantry in the world's bloodiest wars went to battle with little to protect them, because the metal was no match for a bullet. Why? Luckily, I have a personal connection to a place where we can see exactly how metals fail under fire.
This has got to be my favorite spot at MIT, Strobe Alley, dedicated to the work of my great uncle, Harold Edgerton, a pioneer in the art of high-speed photography. I remember when I was a kid, he was always showing us pictures of what he was doing, you know, smashing light bulbs, shooting bullets through apples, stuff like that. I thought, that's the coolest job in the world.
Our plan today is to fire small 22 caliber bullets at several different types of material. Using a high-speed video camera, we'll examine the exact point when the bullet hits, and we'll examine the type of hole it creates. Jim Bales, who runs Strobe Alley, will be our trigger man.
We've got two cameras. This one's running at 20,000 frames a second. This one's down at a mere 4,000 frames a second.
Yeah, and for a point of comparison, normal television like this you're seeing right now is 30 frames a second. So these are running a good bit faster.
First up, a piece of steel. It provides about as much protection as a 15th century breastplate.
Three. Two, one.
Even this small caliber bullet easily penetrates, leaving a jagged hole.
Looks like someone just ripped a hole in a piece of paper.
To provide enough protection for a soldier's torso, this steel would have to be 10 times thicker. It would weigh an unwieldy 100 pounds. What about a lighter weight material, like aluminum? We see it mostly as flimsy rolls of foil, but some forms of aluminum are just as strong as steel and are widely used in aircraft construction. Could aluminum serve as armor?
Lo and behold, there's a hole in the metal. Metallurgist, Mark Eberhardt.
This is beautiful. The energy of the bullet, or much of the energy, went into folding that metal back.
The aluminum shows even more tearing at the point of impact. Pieces of metal light enough to be worn as armor aren't tough enough to stand up to the focused energy of a gunshot. When a bullet strikes the surface, the energy of impact is transferred to the metal, which causes the atoms to slide past each other. Because the energy is focused on such a small area, the movement can be severe, causing cracks to form. If the material is thin enough, the bullet tears right through, like a hot knife through butter. So wearing a full metal jacket into combat is not a wise idea. But if guns made personal armor obsolete, what are these guys wearing? It looks like cloth,
but it's stronger than steel, and it's become standard equipment for soldiers, SWAT teams, and bomb disposal squads. I'm talking about Kevlar. When this synthetic fiber is woven into a fabric, Kevlar is strong enough to stop a bullet or a blade, or even, with a few chemical changes, a fire.
Oh, it's hot. Although not as hot as he is.
David, what you're about to see here are all the examples that we've got of Kevlar.
This is Tucker Norton, ballistics expert and my tour guide here at DuPont, the company that invented this stuff.
Over here, we have some examples of vests where Kevlar is being used.
Can I try one of these on?
Absolutely.
Okay, I'm not here to show off the spring collection, but to understand what makes this stuff so strong. Kevlar, so important to American soldiers today, has its roots in a time when the entire United States was in peril. In the early 30s, the Japanese Empire seized control of the world's silk supply, a material used to make parachutes and flak jackets. A frantic search began for a man-made replacement. Then, in 1935, Wallace Carruthers, a brilliant chemist at DuPont, created nylon, the first fiber made in a test tube, not in nature. His breakthrough ushered in the modern age of synthetics. Then, in the 1960s, Stephanie Kwolek, a chemist also at DuPont, created Kevlar. It remains the strongest synthetic fiber ever produced. I know Kevlar can hold up to the most extreme punishment, but I want to see it up close. Our target, a block of clay, designed to simulate the human torso. It's protected by several layers of Kevlar. On the other end, the weapon. Or rather, the bullet delivery device.
This is the gun?
This is the gun.
Oh, I was
expecting a gun. We don't get out here with a, no, none of that.
Oh, you're kidding. What's going to happen? Someone's going to pull the trigger and, is there a trigger?
So the trigger is located outside of here. We don't actually do anything firing here while we're inside.
Yeah, so these giant safety wusses.
Now here's where we go to fire.
I feel like the president. Fail safe. Okay, ready? Aim, fire.
You did it.
Jeez, I'm so good.
Time to inspect the damage. Even with Kevlar, the simulated chest takes a beating.
Whoa! This would have been my chest?
Turns out, it looks worse than it is.
Unlike a human body, this clay will hold this position. The human body will respond and go back to normal.
So front on human, this would just be a really nasty bruise and
Yes. Maybe
a broken rib?
That's right.
Gotcha.
That's right.
Still, ouch. But where's the bullet? In fact, it's in the bag.
The bullet is still in here.
Oh my gosh. Can we see it?
Absolutely. So we have many, many layers, of course. First one. Second one, and usually about the third layer is where it gets stopped. And there it is. There's the bullet.
Oh my gosh.
It took just four layers of Kevlar, each less than a millimeter thick, to stop the bullet. The seven other sheets kept that hole from getting any deeper.
And as deep as any kind of trauma might look, it's much better than that bullet going all the way through you.
Right, I guess I could agree with that.
Kevlar is clearly some tough stuff.
Whoa.
But how does it work?
So if you were to zoom down at about 100 million times.
We have a really nice camera. Can you zoom down 100 million times?
Kevlar is a polymer, a long repeating chain of atoms. In this case, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Each is like a stiff piece of spaghetti. Gathered into bundles, the stiff chains create a thread-like fiber that has a hard surface, extremely high tensile strength, and enough toughness to absorb the impact of a bullet. Stopping a round is impressive. But there are other threats out there. How does Kevlar stand up to a knife or an ice pick? Don't try this at home.
I'm not gonna pay a lot for this muffler!
That's amazing. How can it do that?
Well, it does it because of the tight weave and because of the strength and durability of Kevlar. The tight weave prevents the spike from getting all the way through, from working its way through, and the strength of the Kevlar actually helps blunt that tip and maybe even bend the tip if you're strong enough.
Since it was invented, Kevlar has been used in all kinds of products, from tires to parachutes and even cables. And that gives me an idea. Tucker, I've got this friend. He's got a fleet of nuclear aircraft carriers, and they have these steel cables a lot like this that are designed to stop aircraft that are landing 130, 150 miles an hour. How does the strength of one of these cables compare with a steel cable?
Well, we'd expect the strength of this, the tensile strength, to be actually equal or better than something like the steel cable.
And it's lighter and it's less dangerous if it snaps.
That's right.
Tucker doesn't think that anyone has ever tested Kevlar arresting cables, but I think I may be onto something. This could be a sales opportunity for you.
We appreciate that. Thank you very much, David.
I'll look for my commission. With tensile strength greater than steel, extreme flexibility and heat resistance, in a package that weighs one-fifth as much as steel, Kevlar could one day be a replacement for steel cables. But already, there may be other, stronger alternatives. Scientists like Ray Bachman at the University of Texas are exploring the remarkable properties of a brand new material, the carbon nanotube.
Dave, this is one type of carbon nanotube.
This is what it's all about right here.
This is what it's all about.
You know, I had a hunch it'd be like this. I just thought they'd be smaller. I'm right. They're about a billion times smaller. Nanotubes are made of carbon atoms arranged in a rolled-up, chicken wire-like structure. Besides nanotubes, there are other forms of pure carbon, like diamond, and graphite, the stuff of pencil lead. Nanotubes get their strength from the extremely strong bonds between carbon atoms.
These carbon nanotubes can have spectacular mechanical properties, spectacular strength, and very high toughness.
And you make them here in this very lab?
Yes, we do.
So this is where it all happens.
This is where the process begins.
And guess what? It's not even that difficult. Here's all you need. One, a smooth surface with a thin layer of catalyst, a chemical that helps jumpstart the tubes. Two, a special mix of gases full of carbon atoms. And three, this furnace, which, by the way, is really, really hot.
How much heat is it in there?
Right now it's around 800 Celsius.
That's about 1500 degrees Fahrenheit.
Wow.
I could nuke a pizza in like 5 seconds in there.
Yeah. You can open more. More?
Oh man, that is blasting heat. Oh, I see the little black wafer in there. That's it?
Yep.
That's nanotubes?
Yeah, exactly.
Wow, that is very cool. Baking away in there. Wow, it's like a nuclear tanning bed. After just a few hours, the wafer is covered with a thick black fuzz. So it looks just like a piece of black velvet. So if I were to really look in close to that, what would I see? What's it really look like under the microscope?
Well, we call this array of carbon nanotubes a nanotube forest.
The name is apt. Each nanotube looks like a tall, thin bamboo tree, hollow inside. So thin that if you could scale one up until it was 1 inch wide at the base, the top of it would reach 2 miles into the sky. Now picture nanotubes by the billions, all standing shoulder to shoulder, and you have one of Ray's nanotube forests.
There are, in fact, about 200 billion of the carbon nanotubes in that area.
Hold on 1 second, I'm gonna count them. Actually, I shouldn't be touching these. Scientists don't yet know if they're toxic. Even so, there's already a rapidly growing market for nanotube particles as strength additives for tennis rackets, bicycle frames, even high-end car bumpers. Many products already incorporate carbon fibers, which are part carbon, part plastic. But nanotubes have greater tensile strength and toughness. Ray has set his sights on making super strong materials that are 100% pure nanotube, made from his nanotube forests.
These aren't just ordinary carbon nanotube forests. They are nanotube forests that have a very special type of connectivity between nanotubes. When we pull out one nanotube, that nanotube pulls out its neighbors, who pulls out other neighbors to self-assemble a yarn or a sheet.
Expert nano yarn spinner Kai Lewis gives me a hands-on lesson.
Would you like to try?
This I recognize. This is that.
First, we start with a forest on a wafer.
So you can just grab on to this little orange tab.
Okay.
Now don't make it too high of an angle and make sure it doesn't touch the edge. And just pull out.
Fast or slow?
Whichever you feel comfortable with.
Oh, dude.
As I pull on this little tab, nanotubes are coming off the wafer, hooking other nanotubes and pulling them off the slide.
Try faster.
I'm so good at this.
And at too high of an angle, it will, as this is now, it'll start to break off from the forest.
It's like coming out forever. I'll see you at the Texas County line.
It's still going.
It's still going. They're broke. And what's even neater, I can show you right here. I can even do a little twist and
make that into
a yarn right here.
Insta yarn.
Look at that.
Wow.
It's about 1/100th of a human hair.
Oh my gosh, it is like steel. I'm pulling really hard. You probably can't even see that. In fact,
and it
look
will
at
stay.
This. It's so fine, you can't even see. Oh, that helps.
Keep twisting. Keep twisting.
Keep twisting, okay. It's amazing.
It's stronger than steel.
Stronger than steel? So why, then, don't you take a bunch of these, twist them together, and make this super cable that'll be like bridge suspension cables and aircraft carrier cables?
Can you imagine spinning a bunch of these all day long to make into a rope that's a foot in diameter?
All right, so go the other way. Make the aircraft carriers really, really small.
Kai does have a point, for now. But in the future, materials we make may be strong, light, and cheap enough to build incredible structures. A bridge across an ocean suspended by fibers like Kevlar or nanotubes. A geodesic dome over an entire city, its structure made of carbon. And in the future, we may not merely make these materials, we may grow them. That's what Mother Nature has been doing for hundreds of millions of years, engineering strength into the bodies of animals, one atom at a time. Meet Mark Myers. He's been fascinated by nature's engineering tricks ever since a boyhood encounter in a Brazilian forest.
My father was hunting, and I saw his entire toucan skeleton. Then I picked up the beak, and I was amazed at how light it was and how strong it was.
The memory stayed with him for 30 years until he happened to stumble across, of all things, a toucan farm. There, he made a startling discovery. In the toucan's amazing beak, nature has constructed a large, lightweight, and amazingly tough structure.
Nice!
He wanted to know how. I'd like to know why. Conservationist Joan Embry is on hand to explain.
What is the point of this huge beak? I mean, it does look a little ridiculous.
Well, they're primarily a fruit eater, and that extends their reach. They use it as a screwdriver, they use it to find food. Also works defensively as a dagger. The edges are serrated.
You tell me that now, when the thing is like 6 inches from my
That's
eye?
That's why you're holding the tame toucan.
Oh!
When Mark analyzed the beak of a dead bird, he found that it was made out of two different materials, neither one of which is strong. On the outside is the shell.
Okay, oh, it's like bendable plastic. It feels like a fingernail.
If the beak was just like this, it would flex. It couldn't grab anything.
The inside of the shell is filled with bone, but bone that's so full of air pockets, it's as weak as styrofoam.
I just show it to you how I can break it, you see?
Right, nothing.
And oh, you should try to.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's foam, so it snaps. Well, it would snap if I had any upper body strength.
The thin shell and the foamy bone. Neither one is tough. But when combined,
you can see that this is the foam, and then we have the shell.
Right, each by itself
is weak.
Is weak.
I can show, if you pull out, you can bend this here very easily, you see?
Yeah.
And
this I could snap if it weren't an important teaching tool for you.
That's right.
Yeah.
And now if you take and try to bend these two together.
Oh, wow. Yeah. It's like super lightweight concrete. It right. feels like nothing.
It is strong and it is very lightweight.
Mark was amazed that evolution had solved such a difficult engineering problem. So he began looking for other examples of animal engineering, which soon led him from the jungle to the beach.
This is your lab? You work in a wetsuit on a table by the ocean?
For today it is. I've been studying actually, Dave, these shells, the abalone, for some years because they are very, very strong.
The abalone has evolved to have a very tough shell, which protects it from the pounding surf and from predators like sea otters.
What is this shell made of? You're saying it's not like other shells.
It's calcium carbonate, which is the same as chalk.
Chalk. Huh.
But it's much, much stronger than chalk.
Yeah, chalk is not especially strong. I noticed by pure coincidence there's a piece of chalk right here, and I don't think of chalk as sea otter proof. I mean, it just crumbles.
It crumbles.
The fact that it pulls apart so easily shows that chalk has very little tensile strength or toughness. But that's not the end of the story. Mark tells me not to be fooled by chalk's apparent weakness because it's actually a very strong material.
And I was never any good with dominoes.
Now, you said that this is weak, right?
Yeah.
You broke it with your...
My bare hands.
Yeah, now I'll show to you that you can put your entire weight here. If you step carefully here.
Can I use you as a ladder?
Yeah.
All right.
Put more in the middle.
More dude. In the middle?
Yeah, yeah.
You've got to be kidding me. This is going to shatter them like glass.
See?
Wow! 185 pounds of pure muscle.
Yes.
Look at that.
What's going on here? Chalk can withstand tremendous pressure. It's called compressive strength, and it's a property of ceramics, the stuff of pottery, bricks, and the cement in concrete. But ceramics also have a weakness. Bend them, drop them, shoot them, or even take a hammer to them.
For your $25 pledge, we'll send you this handsome coffee mug.
And they shatter. As with other materials, the strength or weakness of ceramics is determined by how their atoms bind together. Chalk is made of calcium, carbon, and oxygen atoms, which are bonded together tightly with no wiggle room. They can't slide past each other. That lets them stand up to tremendous pressure. But if a small crack manages to open a space between the atoms, it can quickly spread. That's why materials like chalk, even though they have high compressive strength, often seem fragile. Take glass, another fragile material. Mark insists that it also has high compressive strength, even more than chalk. Frankly, that seems hard to believe.
Okay, here we go. I'm gonna wind up with an ankle full of glass. Oh. My gosh, the chalk is one thing, but these little skinny wine glass stems, something else entirely.
Now, are you willing to try it with three or two?
No. Three glasses! Where's the Cirque du Soleil agent when you need him?
That's amazing,
all right,
you
Mark,
did it.
Explain this in science terms quick.
Ceramics and glasses, when we compress them, they are very, very strong, stronger than metals.
Okay, should we all try right. one?
Yes,
let's
go
do
for
one
it.
Glass.
Let's
one glass, people. Whoa, whoa. Oh my God, I can't believe it. How is this possible?
You did it,
one
Dave.
Glass.
You
I'm
did
amazing.
It. That's the world record.
Oh my gosh. One glass, people. One glass. Watch quickly.
While that is impressive, the abalone shell blows glass and chalk out of the water, so to speak. Like the toucan shell, it combines two materials to make its fortress of strength and protection. Its shell is 95% calcium, carbon, and oxygen, just like the chalk. But it doesn't have the same brittle weakness. It's not fragile.
You're saying this is 95% the same as this,
yeah. But try to break this.
This one, really?
Yeah, go ahead.
This would cost a fortune at the gift shop.
Yeah, go ahead, I dare you.
Okay, if I were a sea otter, I would be a terrible failure. It's completely, no.
The shell demonstrates both compressive strength and toughness, the ability to absorb energy without breaking. Thanks to the way that the abalone has engineered its protective cover on a microscopic scale. As it constructs its shell, the abalone gathers calcium, carbon, and oxygen from the environment to build rows of tiny hexagonal plates. Each plate is brittle, but between the layers, the abalone inserts a protein, a long biological chain. That small addition acts like a shock absorber between the plates. The resulting shell is far less brittle, much tougher, and more crack resistant than simple chalk. As we learn to apply the lessons of microscopic structure, engineers may one day build pressure resistant ceramics and glass from the atom up. Beautiful buildings of sculpted concrete that will never crack and will last 1,000 years. Or a deep sea city with a spectacular view. But when it comes to strong, light, and flexible materials built atom by atom, another natural material may hold the key. It's not new. In fact, it's been around for hundreds of millions of years. It's spider silk. Spider silk has been shown to have more tensile strength than steel and Kevlar. It can stretch to 140% of its length without breaking and remains flexible even in extreme cold. It's also so lightweight that a mere pound of the stuff could form a single strand long enough to stretch around the equator. But could we ever harvest enough to put it to use? I paid a visit to the American Museum of Natural History in New York, where I met Nicholas Godley.
This is it, this is your baby?
This is the big one.
Who enlisted the help of more than 1 million spiders to make this breathtaking piece of fabric.
It's the largest known textile and sample or piece of spider silk in the world.
To truly appreciate this remarkable material, you have to feel it. The main piece is so valuable, it's off limits, even to its creator. But Nicholas has brought a smaller sample.
It feels really, really, really soft. Like animal wool or something.
I challenge you to break off this piece.
I'm gonna break before it does. Okay, it does not, it's like pulling a strand of steel. Wow.
It's beautiful, and it's super strong. Could we ever put spider silk to practical use?
It's very difficult, obviously, to do this on a commercial scale, and it took 1,063,000 spiders, roughly, to make.
Jeez.
It takes about 20 minutes for each spider, and they produce about 400 yards of thread.
Each thread was pulled by hand from a spider's spinneret. It took 4 years and millions of strands to weave this 11-foot-long masterpiece. Its rarity is a testament to the sheer difficulty of harvesting this material. But that may soon change, thanks to this guy.
So here's where we keep our spiders. We have special little cages for them in this room.
Spider Central, huh?
Whoa! Not funny! Not funny! You're now an official Spider-Man affiliate.
This is Randy Lewis, a biologist at the University of Wyoming who's stuck on spider silk.
Wow. This is a golden orb weaver. Golden orb weaver. You just cup your hand and get behind her.
Why is she making web right now?
Because she wants to make sure if she falls, she catches herself.
So she's constantly spinning out that drag line?
Whenever they move, they leave the drag line behind. That's kind of where it got its name.
Randy has been fascinated by the amazing properties of dragline silk for 15 years. And he knows all too well the difficulty of extracting silk from spiders. So he set out to find a way to mass produce the stuff in hopes of revolutionizing the world of strong materials. Wyoming is ranch country. So when Randy began to consider how to solve the problem, his thoughts turned to livestock. He figured maybe he could combine a little old-fashioned animal husbandry with the emerging science of genetic engineering. Now, thanks to Randy, these goats have just a little bit of spider in them. Transgenic, that's the word for what these goats are?
Right, means that they have a gene from another organism that's been put into their chromosomes.
Genes are sections of DNA that contain the encoded instructions for making proteins. Scientists identified the two genes in spider DNA that make silk. They copied one of the genes and spliced it into the DNA of goats so that they would make spider silk protein in their milk.
I'm a little worried about what we're going to find in here. Eight-legged goats, giant
you
dripping webs.
You won't be
able
to tell the normal goats from the transgenic goats because they're all exactly the same.
Oh, I had a dog like you once.
It's impossible just by looking to tell these goats from their non-spidey brethren. But scientifically, they're very valuable.
Yeah, you're special. You've been genetically modified. How does it feel to be genetically modified, huh?
Only 50% of Randy's goats will inherit the necessary gene, and the females that are born with it will go on to produce spider silk protein in their milk. And that's what I've come all this way to see for myself.
Can I try it?
You're certainly welcome to. We normally use the electric just because it's a whole lot faster, but you're welcome to.
Faster, but you've never seen me milk a goat.
All right, well, you're about to find out here.
So this one's skim and this is 2%?
Well, in this case, they're both spider silk, so okay. you can choose either one you want.
Okay, so just grab and tug, just like?
Right, just squeeze down, you can use your fingers and just.
Wow. What percent of this milk is spider silk stuff?
For most of these, it's relatively low. So we're talking about maybe 1 to 2%.
Gives 2% milk a whole new meaning.
That's right, 2%. Yeah, we'd love to see 10%, but we'll take 2% at this point in time.
Next begins the painstaking process of coaxing the silk protein out of the milk.
So we take the milk that we collected out at the farm, we pump it onto this column, which has a whole bunch of very small tubes in it.
All right.
Tubes have holes in it so that the spider silk protein and the milk proteins come out of the tubes and it keeps the fat inside.
So what's left is basically goat skim milk.
Exactly.
Eventually, Randy comes away with a vial of highly concentrated silk protein.
How much milk went into making this tiny drop of?
From our best goats, that would be about a quarter milk.
Wow, and then what? How much silk can you get out of
this? We can get at least 2 to 3 meters.
Wow. All right, let's have a look.
The final step is the most delicate. Randy's team takes the protein liquid and slowly injects it into an alcohol bath, which causes the liquid protein to solidify into a strand of actual spider silk.
So this is it. So this is your man-made spider silk.
This is man-made spider silk.
Now, to prove its metal, Randy loads the strand into a machine that measures tensile strength.
Look, you can start to see it moving.
It is, it's straightening out.
The silk stretches as it resists being pulled until...
It just broke. I'm sorry, Randy.
But there's nothing to be sorry about. A computer measures the force it takes to break the sample, telling them its tensile strength. Remember, the tensile strength of steel, its resistance to being pulled, is what kept my plane from plunging into the ocean. The tensile strength of spider silk appears to be greater than steel or even Kevlar. Not as strong as carbon nanotubes, but more flexible, easier to make in long strands, and certainly not toxic.
We are stronger than Kevlar, we're stronger than steel, we're not stronger than the natural silk.
The spider silk protein demonstrates nature's ingenuity. Its structure is comprised of three distinct sections. Randy compares one of those sections to children's building blocks.
So if you look at a molecular model, what you see is that they have little pins and little holes just like Legos. So if you take and put them together and stack them up like this and you try to pull them apart.
These are proteins here?
These are the proteins, and that's part of the protein. We try to pull it apart, it doesn't pull apart.
Okay, so if I'm pulling this way and this way, and this is the drag line and it's not coming apart.
That's right. So that's one part of the drag line.
Proteins, good for you, okay?
So 400 million years, spider's been playing with Legos.
The second section of the protein is stretchy.
For elasticity, they have something that literally looks like a molecular spring. When you pull on the ends,
right,
it stretches.
Okay, so this
And that's elasticity.
This would be a different protein?
No, it's the same protein. It has different parts.
Okay.
So we have, in the same protein, we have Legos.
Right.
We have springs.
Okay.
And then in order to put them together, we have zippers. Zippers hold things together very well, but they have some flexibility. So you have a way of being able to put this together with a spring. Might be too tight to do that. So you put a zipper in between, and now you have dragline silk.
These basic building blocks repeat over and over again, trillions of them in each strand of silk. The complex structure is evolution's way of enhancing the strength of the common raw materials found everywhere in nature. Before I leave, Randy suggests one last experiment for us would-be Spider-Men.
You getting anything?
I don't feel a thing.
Nothing.
So it seems that the next chapter in the story of strong materials is already upon us.
For thousands of years, we've experimented with our planet's raw materials to make metals and ceramics. Then, through chemistry, we created synthetics and built materials atom by atom. Now, scientists are learning to combine the engineering tricks found in the living world with the incredible strength of our own inventions. With these new tools and materials, there's no telling what we'll be able to accomplish. Once again, propelling human civilization across a new frontier, as has happened again and again over millennia. Every time we learn more about making stuff stronger.
The exploration continues on NOVA's website, where you can investigate the hardest, strongest, and toughest stuff on Earth. Dig into the chemistry that makes some materials rock solid and others flimsy. And take our Facebook quiz. Is your personality more like Kevlar or spandex? Dig deeper into technology and engineering with expert interviews, interactives, teacher resources, and more. Follow NOVA on Facebook and Twitter and find us online at pbs.org.
How far can we go in making stuff smaller?
Do you mind if I have a look?
Host David Pogue investigates the new size and shape of things to come. Micro-robots smaller than bacteria? Computer chips no thicker than an atom?
This here is the future of transistors.
That's a robot?
That's a robot.
That looks like a splinter.
The science of small is taking us to places we've never dreamed we'd go.
It's acquiring images at a rate of 2 frames per second.
Making stuff smaller. Next time on NOVA.
Major funding for NOVA is provided by David H. Koch and
HHMI. Howard Hughes Medical Institute.
And the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and viewers like you. Thank you. Major funding for Making Stuff is provided by the National Science Foundation, where discoveries begin. Additional funding is provided by the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Science. And by American Elements, the world's manufacturer of engineered and advanced materials. American Elements. Now, invent.
Imagine a world with buildings that can ride out earthquakes, bacteria that make gasoline, tiny devices that repair individual cells, even DNA. Gossamer threads strong enough to hold up a bridge or an elevator to the stars. These visions of the future are based in the discoveries of today as a new science of materials emerges from the elemental building blocks of the universe, promising a future in which we can create virtually anything we want, atom by atom.
Can I have some rock music, please?
I'm David Pogue, and I'm on a quest to find the world's most advanced material, a narrow wire that can bring a fighter jet to a dead stop in less than 3 seconds.
Welcome to Navy Airlines.
Super strong, but not unbreakable. What new material might replace it? A man-made fiber that can stop a bullet?
Whoa!
Nature is our guide in this quest.
These are your lab assistants?
Inspired by the beak of a tropical bird.
Arrgh, they were all out of parrots.
Or a lightweight thread spun by spiders, now made from goat's milk.
So this one's skim and this is 2%?
It's stronger than steel. We're learning how to make stuff stronger than ever, and it's going to change the world.
You should try to.
Right now.
It would snap if I had upper body strength.
On Nova.
Major funding for Nova is provided by the following: David H. Koch and
HHMI, Howard Hughes Medical Institute,
and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and viewers like you. Thank you. Major funding for Making Stuff is provided by the National Science Foundation, where discoveries begin. Additional funding is provided by the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Science and by American Elements, the world's manufacturer of engineered and advanced materials. American Elements. Now, invent.
Here I am, inside a Navy plane. I'm on a quest to find the strongest stuff in the world. We're headed for that, the USS John C. Stennis. I can't believe it's possible to land on that thing. But down on that tiny deck, there's a life-saving piece of equipment that's supposed to be strong enough to bring our plane to a dead stop. Man, I hope that thing holds.
Going down.
Whoa. I really felt that. Now I want to see how it works.
Welcome to Navy Airlines.
Luckily, I've arrived at the perfect time, because a dozen new pilots are practicing their landings. That means lots of attempts to catch that wire.
There are actually 4 cables across the deck. They're working on number 3 right now, so this guy's gonna try to catch number 4. That's the ideal one. Let's see if he does it!
The jets land under full power, briefly exerting hundreds of thousands of pounds of force on a cable that's only 1.5 inches thick. How is it possible that such a thin wire can have so much strength? I head below deck to get a closer look.
So I think I understand how these planes land, because I came in on one of these planes. The plane has a hook underneath, and then there's this big steel rubber band on the deck that stretches a little bit and then unstretches. Am I right?
No, sir. It looks like that, yes it does, but that actual rubber band that you're talking about, the actual wire, comes down here and actually leaves from here. This is actually the cable that you're gonna see going across that flight deck.
Every time a plane hits the cable, this powerful hydraulic piston goes into action. By spooling out wire at just the right speed, it counteracts the momentum to slow the aircraft. The bigger the plane, the harder it pulls. It's designed to withstand a truly massive load.
The braking strength of the cable is 215,000 pounds.
That's enough strength to stop four F-18s at once. And it's all thanks to a strong material that the Navy trusts above all others.
The entire ship is made of steel.
Don't believe me? Tell it to the magnet.
Steel.
Steel provides the structural strength of the bulkheads and the decks.
Steel.
And of course, the all-important arresting cable. In the quest to find strong materials, steel is a great place to start. Our modern civilization is built on the stuff. But where does it come from? Thousands of years ago, ancient people used tools made of stone. That's why it's called the Stone Age. But eventually, they discovered how to extract metals, like copper, tin, and iron, from rocks. Iron is the main ingredient in steel, but steel is stronger than iron because it also contains carbon.
All these materials fill the periodic table of the elements, a master chart that lists the basic building blocks of every material in the world, from the lightest to the heaviest, from the weakest to the strongest.
The ability to withstand pulling forces is called tensile strength. And steel has it in abundance. But it's not unbreakable. Each time a plane hits the wire, the impact takes a toll, with potentially disastrous results. In 1993, this fighter had nearly come to a complete stop when the cable suddenly snapped. The plane was lost, but the pilot ejected to safety. Sudden failures like these are rare because the crew doesn't wait for the cables to wear out.
So the doubled up cable down here on the pulleys, you replace that how often?
Every 2,000 arrestments.
And they're connected to one across the deck up there that has to be replaced every?
125.
How come so much more often?
Well, the one on the deck, we call it the cross-deck pennant, or CDP. The CDP takes the blunt force of the tailhook, metal-to-metal contact, at 130 to 140 miles per hour, 125 times.
It's amazing that they haven't found some material in the whole world that would last more than 125 landings.
I don't know of any metal that can do that yet.
Steel has incredible tensile strength. But can it be improved? Can we make this stuff even stronger? That's what Elwood Steel has tried to do for the last century. They've developed and produced high-strength steel for everything from aircraft crankshafts in World War II to high-performance windmill generator shafts and other steel components. It's all based on the same basic materials first combined thousands of years ago.
The end product steel is a mostly iron, 99% or so iron with a little bit of carbon. First we melt it, and then we refine it. We remove all the impurities we can to get the properties that we need from the steel.
At this plant, the raw material is scrap steel to be recycled. First, it's loaded into an electric furnace for melting. When the mix reaches 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, the liquid metal pours out of the bottom of the furnace into a ladle. Today, they're making steel for jumbo jet landing gear, extremely strong and stiff. Besides iron and carbon, the recipe calls for several additional elements added in precise quantities. After cooling, a simple test reveals whether the steel has the right amount of tensile strength.
When we pull a piece of steel, we measure how much it stresses, and we keep increasing the load and watch it stretch until it eventually breaks.
The more force it can withstand, the greater the tensile strength. where does steel's remarkable strength come from? In metals like iron, the atoms are packed together like sheets of marbles. But when pushed or pulled, they can slip and slide past each other. But steel also contains carbon. The carbon atoms fit in between the iron atoms, limiting their freedom of movement and making it harder to pull them apart. Steelmakers long ago learned that by adding more carbon, you can increase the steel's tensile strength, but you give up flexibility, which is something that the arresting cable needs to wind and unwind. The trick is to find just the right balance.
Including steel, there's always been a trade-off between very high hardness, high strength, and flexibility. Steel has provided a very good combination of high strength and good flexibility for many applications. That's why it's so widely used.
Without steel's tensile strength to resist fracture, elevator cables would snap, and bridges would crack in two. That alone makes it an incredibly valuable, strong material. But steel protects us in other ways, too. Car makers depend on a different kind of strength in steel, which is on display at the Outlaw Motor Speedway in Muskogee, Oklahoma. Materials scientist Mark Eberhardt is here to help me understand what makes car bodies strong. And to do that, we first have to watch them break.
Mark, you're a prominent scientist, author, teacher. Why are we at a dirt track in Oklahoma?
I've been fascinated with understanding why things break since I was about 6 years old. You can go into a lab and you can do real detailed experiments. They don't capture the full beauty of why things break. This is the place to come to really understand what a person means when they say strength.
We're the Starsky and Hutch of science nerds. Can I have some rock music, please?
Frankly, I wouldn't mind watching from the stands. But Mark insists that only by becoming crash test dummies ourselves can we understand how steel makes car bodies strong.
Most people don't think of strength as kind of a monolithic thing, but it really is a combination.
Hey, what's your hurry, Pat?
Sorry about that. It's really a combination of properties. It's not just one property, the way most people use the word.
So really, when we say strong as steel, it's a little more complicated than that.
Oh, absolutely.
Besides tensile strength, resistance to pulling, there's also toughness. It's a measure of how much energy a material can absorb without breaking. When a car crashes and the body dents, the steel is absorbing the energy of the crash. That's toughness. During our 100 laps, the car took some serious hits. Did the steel demonstrate toughness?
You know, it's not all that much different from Manhattan at rush hour. Let's check this puppy out.
There's some damage over here.
The body got creamed, but the steel didn't break. It's dented, yet still intact. Our driver, Danny, suggests an even more extreme test of steel's life-saving toughness.
So what do you got set up for us here?
We're gonna take this car, we're gonna send it into the wall and see what we can tear up.
Danny locks the steering wheel in place and opens the throttle. Now, it's up to me to do the honors.
In the name of science!
We installed a small camera where the driver would normally be. The impact was far more intense than anything we experienced during the race.
Mark, talk us through what's going on here.
What we can see here is that we've exhausted a lot of the energy in just crumpling this thing up. I think we knocked the axle all the way back. Tell me, is that the case, Danny?
It looks like it.
Knocked it all the way back into the firewall.
That deal will buff right out.
Would you live, Danny?
I would have had a heart attack somewhere between there and here. I don't know.
Amazingly, the car took everything we threw at it. If the material hadn't been tough, if it had been too brittle, the damage would have been lethal. But in this case, people would have survived because the steel absorbed the energy of the collision. The amount of carbon in the steel is low enough to let the atoms move just a bit, allowing the steel to bend but remain intact. That's toughness.
Who says science can't be fun? That was pretty cool.
Steel makes the biggest structures on Earth possible. And in the future, when buildings reach a mile or more into the sky and bridges stretch across the sea, steel will be there to support humanity's dreams, because we haven't even come close to exhausting the potential of this most precious metal. But no material is perfect. Even metals have their weaknesses. Consider the suit of armor. Warriors once wore bronze, iron, and steel onto the battlefield. Sure, it was heavy, but it provided good protection. Until around the 15th century, when the gun appeared. Heavy armor became a liability. So for hundreds of years, infantry in the world's bloodiest wars went to battle with little to protect them, because the metal was no match for a bullet. Why? Luckily, I have a personal connection to a place where we can see exactly how metals fail under fire. This has got to be my favorite spot at MIT, Strobe Alley, dedicated to the work of my great uncle, Harold Edgerton, a pioneer in the art of high-speed photography. I remember when I was a kid, he was always showing us pictures of what he was doing, you know, smashing light bulbs, shooting bullets through apples, stuff like that. I thought, that's the coolest job in the world.
Our plan today is to fire small 22 caliber bullets at several different types of material. Using a high-speed video camera, we'll examine the exact point when the bullet hits, and we'll examine the type of hole it creates. Jim Bales, who runs Strobe Alley, will be our trigger man.
We've got two cameras. This one's running at 20,000 frames a second. This one's down at a mere 4,000 frames a second.
Yeah, and for a point of comparison, normal television like this you're seeing right now is 30 frames a second. So these are running a good bit faster.
First up, a piece of steel. It provides about as much protection as a 15th century breastplate.
Three. Two, one.
Even this small caliber bullet easily penetrates, leaving a jagged hole.
Looks like someone just ripped a hole in a piece of paper.
To provide enough protection for a soldier's torso, this steel would have to be 10 times thicker. It would weigh an unwieldy 100 pounds. What about a lighter weight material, like aluminum? We see it mostly as flimsy rolls of foil, but some forms of aluminum are just as strong as steel and are widely used in aircraft construction. Could aluminum serve as armor?
Lo and behold, there's a hole in the metal. Metallurgist, Mark Eberhardt.
This is beautiful. The energy of the bullet, or much of the energy, went into folding that metal back.
The aluminum shows even more tearing at the point of impact. Pieces of metal light enough to be worn as armor aren't tough enough to stand up to the focused energy of a gunshot. When a bullet strikes the surface, the energy of impact is transferred to the metal, which causes the atoms to slide past each other. Because the energy is focused on such a small area, the movement can be severe, causing cracks to form. If the material is thin enough, the bullet tears right through, like a hot knife through butter. So wearing a full metal jacket into combat is not a wise idea. But if guns made personal armor obsolete, what are these guys wearing? It looks like cloth,
but it's stronger than steel, and it's become standard equipment for soldiers, SWAT teams, and bomb disposal squads. I'm talking about Kevlar. When this synthetic fiber is woven into a fabric, Kevlar is strong enough to stop a bullet, or a blade, or even, with a few chemical changes, a fire.
Oh, it's hot. Although not as hot as he is.
David, what you're about to see here are all the examples that we've got of Kevlar.
This is Tucker Norton, ballistics expert and my tour guide here at DuPont, the company that invented the stuff.
Over here, we have some examples of vests where Kevlar is being used.
Can I try one of these on?
Absolutely.
Okay, I'm not here to show off the spring collection, but to understand what makes this stuff so strong. Kevlar, so important to American soldiers today, has its roots in a time when the entire United States was in peril. In the early 30s, the Japanese Empire seized control of the world's silk supply, a material used to make parachutes and flak jackets. A frantic search began for a man-made replacement. Then, in 1935, Wallace Carruthers, a brilliant chemist at DuPont, created nylon, the first fiber made in a test tube, not in nature. His breakthrough ushered in the modern age of synthetics. Then, in the 1960s, Stephanie Kwolek, a chemist also at DuPont, created Kevlar. It remains the strongest synthetic fiber ever produced. I know Kevlar can hold up to the most extreme punishment, but I want to see it up close. Our target, a block of clay, designed to simulate the human torso. It's protected by several layers of Kevlar. On the other end, the weapon. Or rather, the bullet delivery device.
This is the gun?
This is the gun.
Oh, I was expecting
we don't get
a
out
gun.
Here with a, no, none of that.
Oh, you're kidding. What's going to happen? Someone's gonna pull the trigger and, is there a trigger?
So the trigger is located outside of here. We don't actually do anything firing here while we're inside.
Yeah, so these giant safety wusses.
Now here's where we go to fire.
I feel like the president. Fail safe. Okay, ready? Aim, fire.
You did it.
Jeez, I'm so good.
Time to inspect the damage. Even with Kevlar, the simulated chest takes a beating.
Whoa! This would have been my chest?
Turns out, it looks worse than it is.
Unlike a human body, this clay will hold this position. The human body will respond and go back to normal.
So front on human, this would just be a really nasty bruise and
yes.
Maybe a broken rib?
That's right.
Gotcha.
That's right.
Still, ouch. But where's the bullet? In fact, it's in the bag.
The bullet is still in here.
Oh my gosh. Can we see it?
Absolutely. So we have many, many layers, of course. First one, second one, and usually about the third layer is where it gets stopped. And there it is. There's the bullet.
Oh my gosh.
It took just four layers of Kevlar, each less than a millimeter thick, to stop the bullet. The seven other sheets kept that hole from getting any deeper.
And as deep as any kind of trauma might look, it's much better than that bullet going all the way through you.
Right. I guess I could agree with that.
Kevlar is clearly some tough stuff.
Whoa.
But how does it work?
If you were to zoom down at about 100 million times.
We have a really nice camera. Can you zoom down 100 million times?
Kevlar is a polymer, a long repeating chain of atoms. In this case, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Each is like a stiff piece of spaghetti. Gathered into bundles, the stiff chains create a thread-like fiber that has a hard surface, extremely high tensile strength, and enough toughness to absorb the impact of a bullet. Stopping a round is impressive. But there are other threats out there. How does Kevlar stand up to a knife or an ice pick? Don't try this at home.
I'm not gonna pay a lot for this muffler!
That's amazing. How can it do that?
Well, it does it because of the tight weave and because of the strength and durability of Kevlar. The tight weave prevents the spike from getting all the way through, from working its way through. And the strength of the Kevlar actually helps blunt that tip and maybe even bend the tip if you're strong enough.
Since it was invented, Kevlar has been used in all kinds of products, from tires to parachutes and even cables. And that gives me an idea.
Tucker, I've got this friend. He's got a fleet of nuclear aircraft carriers, and they have these steel cables a lot like this that are designed to stop aircraft that are landing 130, 150 miles an hour. How does the strength of one of these cables compare with a steel cable?
Well, we'd expect the strength of this, the tensile strength, to be actually equal or better than something like the steel cable.
And it's lighter and it's less dangerous if it snaps.
That's right.
Tucker doesn't think that anyone has ever tested Kevlar arresting cables, but I think I may be onto something.
This could be a sales opportunity for you.
We appreciate that. Thank you very much, David.
I'll look for my commission.
With tensile strength greater than steel, extreme flexibility and heat resistance, in a package that weighs one-fifth as much as steel, Kevlar could one day be a replacement for steel cables. But already, there may be other, stronger alternatives. Scientists like Ray Bachman at the University of Texas are exploring the remarkable properties of a brand new material, the carbon nanotube.
Dave, this is one type of carbon nanotube.
This is what it's all about right here.
This is what it's all about.
You know, I had a hunch it'd be like this. I just thought they'd be smaller.
I'm right. They're about a billion times smaller. Nanotubes are made of carbon atoms arranged in a rolled-up, chicken wire-like structure. Besides nanotubes, there are other forms of pure carbon, like diamond, and graphite, the stuff of pencil lead. Nanotubes get their strength from the extremely strong bonds between carbon atoms.
These carbon nanotubes can have spectacular mechanical properties, spectacular strength, and very high toughness.
And you make them here in this very lab?
Yes, we do.
Ah, so this is where it all happens.
This is where the process begins.
And guess what? It's not even that difficult. Here's all you need. One, a smooth surface with a thin layer of catalyst, a chemical that helps jumpstart the tubes. Two, a special mix of gases full of carbon atoms. And three, this furnace, which, by the way, is really, really hot.
How much heat is it in there?
Right now it's around 800 Celsius.
That's about 1500 degrees Fahrenheit.
Wow, I could nuke a pizza in like 5 seconds in there.
Yeah. You can open more.
Oh man, that is blasting heat. Oh, I see the little black wafer in there, that's it?
Yep.
That's nanotubes?
Yeah, exactly.
Wow, that is very cool, baking away in there. Wow, it's like a nuclear tanning bed.
After just a few hours, the wafer is covered with a thick black fuzz.
So it looks just like a piece of black velvet. So if I were to really look in close to that, what would I see? What's it really look like under the microscope?
Well, we call this array of carbon nanotubes a nanotube forest.
The name is apt. Each nanotube looks like a tall, thin bamboo tree, hollow inside. So thin that if you could scale one up until it was 1 inch wide at the base, the top of it would reach 2 miles into the sky. Now picture nanotubes by the billions, all standing shoulder to shoulder, and you have one of Ray's nanotube forests.
There are, in fact, about 200 billion of the carbon nanotubes in that area.
Hold on 1 second, I'm gonna count them.
Actually, I shouldn't be touching these. Scientists don't yet know if they're toxic. Even so, there's already a rapidly growing market for nanotube particles as strength additives for tennis rackets, bicycle frames, even high-end car bumpers. Many products already incorporate carbon fibers, which are part carbon, part plastic. But nanotubes have greater tensile strength and toughness. Ray has set his sights on making super strong materials that are 100% pure nanotube, made from his nanotube forests.
These aren't just ordinary carbon nanotube forests. They are nanotube forests that have a very special type of connectivity between nanotubes. When we pull out one nanotube, that nanotube pulls out its neighbors, who pulls out other neighbors to self-assemble a yarn or a sheet.
Expert nano yarn spinner Kai Lewis gives me a hands-on lesson.
Would you like to try?
This I recognize. This is that.
First, we start with a forest on a wafer.
So you can just grab on to this little orange tab.
Okay.
Now don't make it too high of an angle and make sure it doesn't touch the edge. And just pull out.
Fast or slow?
Whichever you feel comfortable with.
Oh, dude.
As I pull on this little tab, nanotubes are coming off the wafer, hooking other nanotubes and pulling them off the slide.
Try faster.
I'm so good at this.
And at too high of an angle, it will, as this is now, it'll start to break off from the forest.
It's like coming out forever. I'll see you at the Texas County line!
It's still going.
It's still going. They're broke. And what's even neater, I can show you right here. I can even do a little twist and make that into a yarn right here.
Insta yarn.
Look at that.
Wow.
It's about 1/100th of a human hair.
Oh my gosh, it is like steel. I'm pulling really hard. You probably can't even see that. Mm-hmm. In fact,
and it
look
will
at
stick.
This. It's so fine, you can't even see. Oh, that helps.
Keep twisting. Keep twisting.
Keep twisting, okay. It's amazing.
It's stronger than steel.
Stronger than steel? So why, then, don't you take a bunch of these, twist them together, and make this super cable that'll be like bridge suspension cables and aircraft carrier cables?
Can you imagine spinning a bunch of these all day long to make into a rope that's a foot in diameter?
All right, so go the other way. Make the aircraft carriers really, really small.
Kai does have a point, for now. But in the future, materials we make may be strong, light, and cheap enough to build incredible structures. A bridge across an ocean suspended by fibers like Kevlar or nanotubes. A geodesic dome over an entire city, its structure made of carbon. And in the future, we may not merely make these materials, we may grow them. That's what Mother Nature has been doing for hundreds of millions of years, engineering strength into the bodies of animals, one atom at a time. Meet Mark Myers. He's been fascinated by nature's engineering tricks ever since a boyhood encounter in a Brazilian forest.
My father was hunting, and I saw his entire toucan skeleton, and then I picked up the beak, and I was amazed at how light it was and how strong it was.
The memory stayed with him for 30 years until he happened to stumble across, of all things, a toucan farm. There, he made a startling discovery. In the toucan's amazing beak, nature has constructed a large, lightweight, and amazingly tough structure.
Nice!
He wanted to know how. I'd like to know why. Conservationist Joan Embry is on hand to explain.
What is the point of this huge beak? I mean, it does look a little ridiculous.
Well, they're primarily a fruit eater, and that extends their reach. They use it as a screwdriver. They use it to find food. Also works defensively as a dagger. The edges are serrated.
You tell me that now, when the thing is like 6 inches from my
That's
eye?
That's why you're holding the tame toucan.
Oh!
When Mark analyzed the beak of a dead bird, he found that it was made out of two different materials, neither one of which is strong. On the outside is the shell.
Okay, oh, it's like bendable plastic. It feels like a fingernail.
If the beak was just like this, it would flex. It couldn't grab anything.
The inside of the shell is filled with bone, but bone that's so full of air pockets, it's as weak as styrofoam.
I just show it to you how I can break it, you see?
Right, nothing.
And oh, you should try to.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's foam, so it snaps. Well, it would snap if I had any upper body strength.
The thin shell and the foamy bone. Neither one is tough. But when combined...
You can see that this is the foam, and then we have the shell.
Right, each by itself...
Is weak.
Is weak.
I can show, if you pull out, you can bend this here very easily, you see?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this I could snap if it weren't an important teaching tool for you.
That's right.
Yeah.
And now if you take and try to bend these two together.
Oh, wow. Yeah. It's like super lightweight concrete. It right. feels like nothing.
It's strong and it is very lightweight.
Mark was amazed that evolution had solved such a difficult engineering problem. So he began looking for other examples of animal engineering, which soon led him from the jungle to the beach.
This is your lab? You work in a wetsuit on a table by the ocean?
For today it is. I've been studying actually, Dave, these shells, the abalone, for some years because they are very, very strong.
The abalone has evolved to have a very tough shell, which protects it from the pounding surf and from predators like sea otters.
What is this shell made of? You're saying it's not like other shells.
It's calcium carbonate, which is the same as chalk.
Chalk. Huh.
But it's much, much stronger than chalk.
Yeah, chalk is not especially strong. I noticed by pure coincidence there's a piece of chalk right here, and I don't think of chalk as sea otter proof. I mean, it just crumbles.
It crumbles.
The fact that it pulls apart so easily shows that chalk has very little tensile strength or toughness. But that's not the end of the story. Mark tells me not to be fooled by chalk's apparent weakness because it's actually a very strong material.
And I was never any good with dominoes.
Now, you said that this is weak, right?
Yeah.
You broke it with your...
My bare hands.
Yeah, now I'll show to you that you can put your entire weight here. If you step carefully here.
Can I use you as a ladder?
Yeah.
All right.
Put more in the middle.
More in the middle?
Yeah, yeah.
You gotta be kidding me. This is gonna shatter them like glass.
See?
Wow! 185 pounds of pure muscle.
Yes.
Look at that.
What's going on here? Chalk can withstand tremendous pressure. It's called compressive strength, and it's a property of ceramics, the stuff of pottery, bricks, and the cement in concrete. But ceramics also have a weakness. Bend them, drop them, shoot them, or even take a hammer to them.
For your $25 pledge, we'll send you this handsome coffee mug.
And they shatter.
As with other materials, the strength or weakness of ceramics is determined by how their atoms bind together. Chalk is made of calcium, carbon, and oxygen atoms, which are bonded together tightly with no wiggle room. They can't slide past each other. That lets them stand up to tremendous pressure. But if a small crack manages to open a space between the atoms, it can quickly spread. That's why materials like chalk, even though they have high compressive strength, often seem fragile.
Take glass, another fragile material. Mark insists that it also has high compressive strength, even more than chalk. Frankly, that seems hard to believe.
Okay, here we go. I'm gonna wind up with an ankle full of glass. Oh my gosh, the chalk is one thing, but these little skinny wine glass stems, something else entirely.
Now, are you willing to try it with three or two?
No. Three glasses! Where's the Cirque du Soleil agent when you need him?
That's amazing, right, you
Mark,
did it.
Explain this in science terms quick.
Ceramics and glasses, when we compress them, they are very, very strong, stronger than metals.
Okay, should we All try right. one?
Yes,
let's
go for it.
Let's do one glass. One glass, people. Whoa. Oh my God, I can't believe it. How is this possible?
You did it,
one
Dave.
Glass.
You
I'm
did
amazing.
It. That's the world record.
Oh my gosh. One glass, people. One glass. Watch quickly.
While that is impressive, The abalone shell blows glass and chalk out of the water, so to speak. Like the toucan shell, it combines two materials to make its fortress of strength and protection. Its shell is 95% calcium, carbon, and oxygen, just like the chalk. But it doesn't have the same brittle weakness. It's not fragile.
You're saying this is 95% the same as this,
yeah. But try to break this.
This one, really?
Yeah, go ahead.
This would cost a fortune at the gift shop.
Yeah, go ahead, I dare you.
Okay, if I were a sea otter, I would be a terrible failure. it's completely, nope.
The shell demonstrates both compressive strength and toughness, the ability to absorb energy without breaking. Thanks to the way that the abalone has engineered its protective cover on a microscopic scale. As it constructs its shell, the abalone gathers calcium, carbon, and oxygen from the environment to build rows of tiny hexagonal plates. Each plate is brittle, but between the layers, the abalone inserts a protein, a long biological chain. That small addition acts like a shock absorber between the plates. The resulting shell is far less brittle, much tougher, and more crack resistant than simple chalk. As we learn to apply the lessons of microscopic structure, engineers may one day build pressure resistant ceramics and glass from the atom up. Beautiful buildings of sculpted concrete that will never crack and will last 1,000 years. Or a deep sea city with a spectacular view. But when it comes to strong, light, and flexible materials built atom by atom, another natural material may hold the key. It's not new. In fact, it's been around for hundreds of millions of years. It's spider silk. Spider silk has been shown to have more tensile strength than steel and Kevlar. It can stretch to 140% of its length without breaking and remains flexible even in extreme cold. It's also so lightweight that a mere pound of the stuff could form a single strand long enough to stretch around the equator. But could we ever harvest enough to put it to use? I paid a visit to the American Museum of Natural History in New York, where I met Nicholas Godley.
This is it, this is your baby?
This is the big one.
Who enlisted the help of more than 1 million spiders to make this breathtaking piece of fabric.
It's the largest known textile and sample or piece of spider silk in the world.
To truly appreciate this remarkable material, you have to feel it. The main piece is so valuable, it's off limits, even to its creator. But Nicholas has brought a smaller sample.
It feels really, really, really soft. Like animal wool or something.
I challenge you to break off this piece.
I'm gonna break before it does. Okay, it does not break. It's like pulling a strand of steel. Wow.
It's beautiful and it's super strong. Could we ever put spider silk to practical use?
It's very difficult, obviously, to do this on a commercial scale. And it took 1,063,000 spiders, roughly, to make.
Jeez.
It takes about 20 minutes for each spider, and they produce about 400 yards of thread.
Each thread was pulled by hand from a spider's spinneret. It took 4 years and millions of strands to weave this 11-foot-long masterpiece. Its rarity is a testament to the sheer difficulty of harvesting this material. But that may soon change, thanks to this guy.
So here's where we keep our spiders. We have special little cages for them in this room.
Spider Central, huh?
Whoa! Not funny! Not funny! You're now an official Spider-Man affiliate.
This is Randy Lewis, a biologist at the University of Wyoming who's stuck on spider silk.
Wow, this is a golden orb weaver. Golden orb weaver. You just cup your hand and get behind her.
Why is she making web right now?
Because she wants to make sure if she falls, she catches herself.
So she's constantly spinning out that drag line?
Whenever they move, they leave the drag line behind. That's kind of where it got its name.
Randy has been fascinated by the amazing properties of dragline silk for 15 years. And he knows all too well the difficulty of extracting silk from spiders. So he set out to find a way to mass produce the stuff in hopes of revolutionizing the world of strong materials. Wyoming is ranch country. So when Randy began to consider how to solve the problem, his thoughts turned to livestock. He figured maybe he could combine a little old-fashioned animal husbandry with the emerging science of genetic engineering. Now, thanks to Randy, these goats have just a little bit of spider in them. Transgenic, that's the word for what these goats are?
Right, means that they have a gene from another organism that's been put into their chromosomes.
Genes are sections of DNA that contain the encoded instructions for making proteins. Scientists identified the two genes in spider DNA that make silk. They copied one of the genes and spliced it into the DNA of goats so that they would make spider silk protein in their milk.
I'm a little worried about what we're gonna find in here. Eight-legged goats, giant
you
dripping webs.
You won't be able to tell the normal goats from the transgenic goats because they're all exactly the same.
Oh, I had a dog like you once.
It's impossible just by looking,